Hey, sports card collectors and investors. I hope that everybody is having a great Wednesday. I'm coming to you with a topic that I don't really get, I don't see it talked about very much as far as content creators go. And so I wanted to touch on it. And again, I kind of try to balance out these videos. We have a lot of, you know, exciting times with cards going up, you know, because that's been kind of the norm the last 12 months. But I also want to, you know, also exercise caution and just talk about the other side of that when it comes to sports card investing, because I think it's something that's important to talk about, because you just never know how things are going to go as we move forward. And in collectibles investing, things can be very, well, just like with a lot of different types of investing, it's an up and down, ebb and flow, you know, type game. Just look at the stock market, look at real estate. You know, not everything just goes up forever. It doesn't work like that. And so I think that, you know, it's a good idea to, you know, certainly hedge, you know, with other things, but then also just be aware that, you know, and not get maybe caught up with a lot of the emotions that come with, you know, this hobby and other hobbies for that matter. So I'll go ahead and jump right into it. So first off, you know, I want to talk about just, you know, as an investor or collector, I think it's important to just kind of figure out, kind of keep your emotions in check. Emotional intelligence, obviously, in life, I feel like is extremely important. But for me, I'm always just trying to check myself as to, you know, when I'm looking on eBay. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I feel like I could spend $1 million a day on eBay just looking at cards and all the different buying opportunities. Now, some of those buying opportunities maybe are manufactured in my head. You know, lately I've been talking a little bit about how I've been picking up Drew Brees. That could just be, you know, the football season is coming up. I'm getting excited about it. Yeah, I do anticipate some good things happening with his cards. Not necessarily all of his cards, but there's certain ones that I'm picking and choosing among some of the other players. You know, and the same goes with, you know, with basketball. Now we know basketball is going to start back up again. So there's an emotional drive to, you know, to a lot of this. And I just have to, you know, from an investment standpoint, have to kind of keep my emotions in check. I can't necessarily bid on every auction that comes my way. You know, whether it be, you know, Luka Doncic, or LeBron or some of these other guys that I target. Luka's kind of my, you know, that's the one. You know, it's not just me, it's a lot of people. I mean, a lot of people want Luka cards. So I think with the excitement that he's brought into the league, you know, he is the first one, you know, since kind of Giannis has picked up steam over the last few years. You know, Zion has brought a lot of hype into this. So, you know, there's a lot to be excited about with NBA basketball, and then with NFL football too. There's just this tiny, you know, gap in talent really between most of the teams. You know, so really, if you're a fan, you know, there's, you know, just so much to be excited about, and that translates into cards, especially when you don't have fantasy football, you don't have sports betting, you know, so it's pushed a lot of, you know, people into this, and it makes a lot of sense. When I was a kid getting into this in the late 80s, I've talked about this in previous videos, you know, for me, and for you all that were around during that time as well, I'm sure you can remember, I mean, there was no DirecTV Sunday ticket. You know, it's not like you could turn on, you know, Sunday or go, you know, to the sports bar and they had 16 games on for you to watch. That's not how it was. I mean, it was, you know, I didn't even have cable in the late 80s, let alone, you know, anything else. So, I mean, I remember the feeling that I got when a Saints game came on TV, on national TV, well, or regionally where I was. You know, I was pumped out of my mind, and I didn't even have like a TV guide or anything. It was just like, okay, I know the games start on Sundays at 12, 1 o'clock, you know, so I was watching, you know, to see if my team was on, and if I was lucky, you know, back then Saints 49ers was a huge rivalry. They were in the same division, so, you know, if I was lucky that, you know, that they were on, then I was pumped up about it. And I think as a kid, for me to kind of feel more involved with my team, you know, it was starting lineup toys, and it was and sports cards, you know, it's football cards, you know, so that was the way that I could feel closer to my team. Because now with the internet, there's a zillion different ways. My gosh, with Twitter and Instagram, you can follow all your favorite players if you want to. Back then, they were like gods, you know, I mean, you couldn't touch them, and you couldn't see them unless you were local to that team and be able to go to a practice or a training camp or something like that. It just wasn't possible for fans to have that inside, you know, look into pro sports. Now it's completely different. Now it's almost like we have too much we're too involved in pro sports. So the landscape has changed tremendously, but that is what really got, you know, collecting and investing in cards. Because like I said, that was when Beckett price guides started coming out and giving values on cards, and that was what my buddies and I used to trade. But then also, you know, when working with dealers, now, as I mentioned before, dealers used to get me all the time. I was a 9-year-old kid and they were grown men and negotiating with me. I lost a lot, but you know, it was my first kind of foray into business, and so that's what kind of, you know, that's the collecting investing paradigm spectrum that we all kind of have some of. And I think that that's what I want to make a big point on is, you know, people that are just jumping into this to make money because they're seeing that over the last 12 months that there's been great money being made on like Luka or LeBron or MJ or those types of players, and even with some of the, you know, the newer players as well, you could almost throw money at a mix of players and you probably did okay over the last 12 months. It's just been an unprecedented time in sports card investing. It won't always be that way in my mind. I mean, what goes up has to come down at some point. There has to be corrections with certain players. And you have to keep in mind too that we're essentially speculating on a player's career. So, you know, just like, you know, Luka might play for 20 years and have a, you know, win 5 championships and be in that GOAT conversation, or he might have a career-ending freak injury like Bo Jackson did in the late 80s. You know, Bo Jackson was going to be the greatest player of all time, you know, baseball, football. The hype around Bo Jackson was insane. And for the younger viewership that don't know who I'm talking about with Bo Jackson, or you go watch, I think there's a Football Life, there's 30 for 30s, there's of course, there's highlights all over YouTube, but go watch Bo Jackson's baseball and his football highlights, and you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. Point is his cards were very expensive in the 80s relative to the time period, and his cards are still, they're still not inexpensive now, but they're very affordable now. And unfortunately, he just had a freak hip career-ending injury that made that happen. So we have to always keep in mind that, you know, not everyone's going to be LeBron or MJ. It's very likely that they won't be. The percentages are actually extremely high that they won't be LeBron or MJ. They're very low that they will be. So, I mean, Luka could turn, who knows, maybe defenses adjust to him, Zion, maybe defenses adjust to him, and he starts, and he has, maybe he's got an average career, but is he going to be, you know, top 5 player of all time, top 25 player of all time? You know, that's, you know, odds are low that that will happen. It could very well happen, but odds are low. So, you know, when we look at these prices that where they sit now, you know, we just have to kind of keep that in mind. Are there still buying opportunities with Luka and Zion? Sure, I think that there are some. But are there, you know, loads of different opportunities? I wouldn't say there's loads of them just compared to where his pricing was and where it is now. So, and we'll have to see even where it goes once basketball starts back up. It's probably, you know, if we're kind of looking at the way that it's gone over the last few years, you know, the excitement of sports, if he has a great game, if Luka drops 50 in a game 6, 7, you know, whatever, things could go crazy. So it's not to say that cards are bound to drop. It's just we have to be realistic when investing. It's no different when you know, if we buy Coca-Cola stock, you know, it's going to rise and fall, and there is no way of knowing that. There are, you could do all the research that you want and it could still fall. So I think that that's the main point. If you're getting into it just for the money, you have to really love sports as well, because there's just a boatload of research that you have to do to stay on top of it. And then even if you do all the research and you're on top of it, you can still lose. These things can still go down. You know, so it's just something that we all have to keep in mind, you know, as we kind of roll through this. Collectibles investing and sports card investing is not a established financial asset class, you know, to where you can get into the stock market. I can get into the stock market without having a love for these companies or having a love for finance. All I have to do is just pick an index fund and I'm able to invest in the index. That does not exist for sports cards or, you know, or collectibles investing from what I've seen. It's just not as established, you know, with the stock market, you're betting on the U.S. economy, essentially. You know, companies, you know, the top 500, if you're looking at the S&P 500, top 500 companies, you know, so that is a much, I mean, just when you're talking about diversifying your money, that is about as diverse as you can get is spreading it out between the largest companies and the most profitable companies in the country. Can it go up? Will it go up and down? Absolutely, it will. But, you know, it's definitely more of a established financial asset class. Sports card investing is not. There's not any regulations. There's not, you know, we don't have an index fund to invest in the index. It's just not as organized. Maybe one day it'll get there, just because you have a lot of these younger generations that are more interested in these types of collectibles and, you know, the collectible investments. But, you know, we're not there yet. So lastly, I'll end on the research component of this game is incredibly, incredibly important. If your buddies are telling you, hey, I just made $1,000 flipping a LeBron card, you know, sure, you know, maybe they just were right place, right time, just happened to have that card. But realistically though, it's incredibly important if you're gonna have a chance at winning and a chance at profiting, that you have to do a lot of research. You have to look at trends. You have to look at eBay sold listings. You have to look at what's happening on other sites like ComC and maybe some of the other sales sites. Pay attention to, you know, issues in our marketplace, such as shill bidding and bid rigging on auctions. You don't want to get trapped in something like that, caught in it. So there's pitfalls along the way that, you know, you just have to pay close attention to. And just because you're, you know, a Steelers fan doesn't necessarily mean that Ben Roethlisberger's cards are the way to go, or could, you know, are certain to go up because you think the Steelers are going to have a great year. I mean, there's so much more to it. And while it's important, it's kind of a funny balance. You have to have the passion for sports and the emotion that goes into following sports. At the same time, you have to keep your emotions in check when you're investing and collecting these things, because it's not just going to be a, you know, your favorite team that sees gains just because sports cards in general are going up. So guys, thank you so much for joining me for this. I want to open up, you know, this conversation. I know that there's a huge debate as to, you know, collecting and investing sports cards, and some people are against investing and some people, you know, think that collecting is silly only. So, you know, I mean, there's a lot to talk about within this world, and I want to open up that conversation. So please comment below. And let me know your thoughts. And if there are other topics kind of related around this that you want to hear about, let me know and we'll get it out. We'll certainly take a look at making a video on it. Thank you again for watching, and we will see you again next time. Take care, guys.